Welcome to the Expanding Worlds podcast. I'm your host, Deborah Keldo. Over the last 9 episodes, you've heard from people working in an organisation based in the UK called Grace Eyre. This was a shift for me in some ways, doing a profile series, because usually when I talk to professionals, I'm talking to one person from an organisation. But with Grace Eyre, it was about everything from the history of how people with additional needs were treated, to housing, to work, to the rights of people having a voice in their own futures. I've listened back to all of these quite a bit, partly because I still do edit my own podcasts. Now, many of my fellow podcasters will tell me that's a waste of my time, but I disagree. And there are two reasons I still do this part myself. One is the learning, because as I listen to these multiple times, I pick up a new point or an idea that gives me inspiration to support my own daughter. But the main reason is I want to keep this podcast an authentic space to share. This isn't a business or marketing or productivity podcast. It can be about some pretty emotional stuff, because we're talking about changing the futures of our children, a topic hard not to get emotional about. And I want to make sure people feel that I take the time to share their stories. Before we go any further, I want to quickly mention the show's sponsor. Podcasts don't pay for themselves, and although I do a lot of the work myself, I still pay others for those things I'm not very good at. And that's all paid for by the show's sponsor, Red Giraffe Solutions, and who I work for in my day job. Over there, I've developed online courses built around the Red Giraffe, Route Map, and the Vocal Method, both of which provide a framework for parents to create a life plan for their children. As part of this, I now offer one-to-one coaching built around these same frameworks that we've used to plan out my daughter's future. So if you're interested in working with me one-to-one, then you can book a free exploratory call at redgiraffesolutions.com. Over this profile series, I learned an awful lot, and to me it fell into three parts: the past, the present, and the future. Like every parent with a child with additional needs, the past has been bumpy. When I started on this journey with my daughter, I often felt I was alone. I didn't know anyone in my position. But of course, over time, you find people on the same journey, usually at a hospital or in a parent group or at school. I've spoken before about the impact on relationships and the friends that I've gained and lost over the years. At the beginning, my focus was 100% on my daughter and what was happening in front of me, what we as her family needed to be doing right then and there, not the wider picture of what the future for her might look like, or even how people with additional needs are treated within society. The conversations I had about the history of Grace Eyre, the organisation, and the woman Grace Eyre, helped me increase my understanding of how far we've come. This was particularly the case with the Sharing Our Voices project, where they'd spoken to people who were now in their 50s and 60s and older about their lives. It's really hard to imagine for me that my daughter would be put into a home and then, if she was lucky, be found a job and work at that job for her entire life with little autonomy to decide where she went, who she saw, and how she lived. And of course, it's important to acknowledge here that Grace Eyre were an awful lot more progressive than most other organisations at that time. And also, they now recognise that what went on wasn't acceptable. But what's worrying is that we still hear stories about organisations doing similar things, often supported by government, following this really restrictive model. But today, progressive organisations like Grace Eyre, it's all about choice. The word choice came up a lot in my conversations in this series, and that's where we are at the moment. The point where, as one of my guests said, young people with additional needs have much higher expectations in terms of making decisions for themselves. They expect to have a voice in choosing how they live, where they live, the types of jobs they apply for. There are both internal and external factors at play here. The messages young people are hearing at home are clearly more positive, and externally, there are more organisations who value inclusion and diversity, which then opens up new opportunities, especially when it comes to work. Grace Eyre are a part of this in terms of the programs they have for supporting people into work, but there are also a couple of ways that Grace Eyre are ahead of the game. The first is ensuring that the people they work with have a seat at the table. That is, rather than just training people, they often employ people with additional needs in roles based on their skill sets, and this also extends to their board of trustees. Then there's the idea of having mentors with lived experience. We are best guided by people who understand our journey and who can advise us on something they have experienced themselves. What I also learned is how much as a parent I can be doing right now, and that with the right support, my daughter can make giant steps towards independence, and that includes living on her own. I've always had reservations about supported living in general, but now I know that is very much an umbrella term for a lot more other innovative ideas like shared lives and housing options where, for want of a better description, people live in ordinary streets, in ordinary houses, with as little as or as much support as they want. And sometimes it's the simple things that have the biggest impact, like the Travel Buddies independent travel scheme at Grace Eyre. This scheme has enabled people to take on opportunities they wouldn't have had before, especially around work and also social opportunities. And even though I can't access this scheme for my daughter, many of the ideas they use are very transferable. And I've now started to support her independent travel in a much more structured and focused way. Gracie has a very joined up approach, and I think that's having a bigger impact, and that's something that other organisations could learn from. So what of the future? Well, with increased confidence, our young people become their own advocates, and that's what we should be aiming for. Less of the doing for ethos and more of the not even doing with, but doing what we're told. This requires people's voices to be heard, so the concept of the other will need to change. It's pointless putting in place things that people haven't asked for and don't want. This idea of othering really needs to be challenged. It's something I've thought about a lot. It's bothered me for some time that there's this idea that my daughter is special. Honestly, she isn't. She's like most 20-year-olds, fiercely independent, annoying and condescending all at the same time. Yes, she learns differently, but as someone said in this series, if we all have abilities, then by that token, we must all have disabilities. I recently wrote an article about how I believe visibility is the key, because the more we see people, the less we notice them. And how important that is in coming to that point where it's ordinary for someone with additional needs to have a job, live next door, or be in a relationship. One area which I do see Grace Eyre showing a better way is by ensuring that people with lived experience are in decision-making roles. No matter how good our intentions are, we cannot be doing for people. We must be doing with them, but even then, we often make that final decision about the how. What is really required is for more people with lived experience to have the information they need in a way that works for them to enable them to be genuinely involved in any decision-making process that impacts on their lives. Like every other person, my daughter has the right to determine her own future. Perhaps the biggest barrier she faces in doing this is the preconceptions of others. Organisations like Grace Eyre understand her right to decide will help her to navigate the ignorant and overcome the barriers put in her way. Thanks for listening. This is the last episode of this series, so I'll be back in a few weeks with a new series focused on housing. I've got some great guests already from both the UK and the USA, but I am looking for more guests for this series. So if you know about a housing scheme or a project that you think could be part of the series, please get in touch. You can email me, deborah@expandingworlds.com. If you enjoyed the episode, then it'd be great if you could leave a review wherever you listen, because this helps other people find the podcast. And of course, if you'd like to connect, you can find me on Instagram @deborahcaldo.